find extraordinary that the end of 1960 something and early 70s, we got the job almost by default, really, of having a go at a railway engine. I'd never done anything like that in my life. I was mostly done mixers for Kenwood. Never say die is the motto in our trade, really. So the first opportunity I got was actually to be asked to advise on the decoration of a model that had been produced by the engineering department at Derby of this train. We had time on our hands and access to a wind tunnel, so we gradually developed a shape that is as near as damn it what I'm standing in front of now. And so it became this vehicle, which is a remarkable piece of railway history and in its own right deserves a place in, as it has got a place and will have forever, I think, have a place in our national history of railways, because it became an iconic shape and an iconic demonstration, or let's say an icon for the future of the railways, which was a very bright and optimistic future. And indeed it was a very optimistic time for the whole of design in this country, with decent railways, decent architecture, such important things as we now, over history, have learned, even the importance of this symbol, which then picked up worldwide as the symbol of high-speed train travel. I had my little part in what's become a very important part of the whole history of our country. And railways is an absolutely key part of the whole of our lives. It's a great privilege to be here, and I'm greatly indebted to all the extraordinary effort that's gone into this, both on the part of people giving their own time and skill, but also the people who've also supported with money and sponsorship and assistance. So it's a collective effort, and I enjoy the sunshine of standing here and all these photographs from that game. But really, my part's a very, very little part compared with what all you folk have done. I owe you all a huge debt, so thanks for letting me come today, and may it go on forever.
So many of you are here. I was asked about 3 months ago whether we could do this trip. I think it was Darren came up to me and said, we'd like to take a set up to Ruddington to do a bit of a test run. And I imagined it would be quite a fair. We might have perhaps a couple of dozen people. So it's fantastic that we've got about 300 that we managed to bring here today. Very much looking forward to the trip. It has been, this is, as you know, the culmination of about 4 years of work by the 125 group under the Project Miller banner. We've just been a small part of it, really, as we are today. The hours of work that the team have done to get 41001 back to working order, it's all credit to them, really. It was a pleasure to see the power car at Etches Park a few weeks ago, and a pleasure to get in the cab of it then, and I'm very much looking forward to the trip now. So to congratulate all the group, well done, and let's wish 41001 a great first passenger trip in 38 years. Thank you.
Thanks very much for the brief. What brings us on a Saturday afternoon in not the best weather conditions to come and experience something like this? Well, of course, it is this power car. It is very much to celebrate the high-speed train, the 125, which is an incredible piece of railway history, as Sir Kenneth talked about. But who would have thought just recently that 27 sets will shortly be heading up to Scotland, where they will probably achieve their 50th year in traffic? I mean, quite an incredible achievement. Perhaps not quite so good if you want to preserve one. But nevertheless, it's a fantastic achievement we have here, and I think not only does the high-speed train still to today achieve a wonderful thing in terms of delivering great service safely for our customers and passengers every day, it makes some fantastic noises, which I guess is particularly relevant to this power car. But the other thing, just being serious for a moment, of course, it really works at an economic level as well. It's been said many times, and I really believe it to be true, that we've had the HST not been developed when it was, in the way that it was, at the time of real challenge and cost for the UK rail industry, we probably wouldn't have the intercity network that we have today. We probably wouldn't have the intercity network that then's gone on to be able to grow, whether that be with them, you know, on the East Coast or soon to be IEPs. So I think as people that support in the railway, we owe the development of this train an enormous debt of gratitude, because it allowed us in some really difficult times to deliver some really good customer service in a really efficient and economic way. And that fundamentally is what the train's all about. And it sounds good. So congratulations to the Project Miller, to the 125 group, and to the National Railway Museum for, I think, having the confidence to do it. And I think a big credit to the guys at Neville Hill, who really supported the whole thing from the beginning. So we're looking forward to the run today. Thanks very much.
I think we owe an enormous debt of gratitude to the high-speed train prototype as well at the National Rail Museum. Because quite literally, without it, the Railway Museum would not have opened. I do need to quantify that. It wouldn't have opened on time. That's because the prototype itself conveyed Prince Philip, the Duke of Edinburgh, from London to York to officially open the museum on the 27th of September 1975, which is just a month after I first glimpsed this vehicle, aged five myself, at the Shildon Cavalcade marking 150th anniversary of the Stockton-Darlington Railway. I maybe should point out the fact that Prince Philip did actually arrive 25 minutes late because one of the power cars did go on fire, but we'll gloss over that as BR did at the time. But the train was sufficiently able to then convey Prince Philip to Eaglescliff later on that day. Although it wasn't able to achieve the 125, it did manage to go up to 105 and arrived on time. So a great testimony to this fantastic vehicle. So a huge amount of thanks to everybody here, really. It's a perfect project for the National Rail Museum, because you see behind us the fantastic job that's been done here by so many people here today. And yet it didn't cost the National Rail Museum a penny. And it's not caused a single man hour from Rail Museum staff time either. So thanks to everybody for doing all that for us. It really is appreciated greatly. And I think it's a great testament to this industry, and also the way that this industry considers and respects and welcomes this fantastic locomotive and train. And as you've heard earlier, of course, they're going to be cascaded to my native Scotland as well. So I'm doing routes up to Aberdeen. So like their successes to the great A4s, who had their swan song going between Glasgow and Edinburgh to Aberdeen, the HST will certainly be doing that, but for many, many years to come, and hopefully for many years after that too. Okay, thank you.
Very good. Oh, that's fine.